you know, it's music takes over. I'm looking to transcend myself, all my insecurities, all my worries, everything has to leave. For the audience to truly believe that I'm in that special place that a performer should try and reach, you know, it's not about, you know, it's about reaching this place that I can't normally reach on a day-to-day basis. That's what performance is. So whether I was with the Verve on my own, completely on my own, it really doesn't matter.
Well, that's the thing about music, right?
Yeah.
Like, everybody has to feel what you are feeling, to know what you already know.
Yeah.
I'm going to tell something that I was reading just yesterday, that Chris Martin said that you have the best voice all over the world. Chris Martin from Coldplay. And the thing is, I think the same thing about it. You really have a great voice. And I really want to know, how did you discover that? Because not everybody knows which talent they have in their life, right? So you discovered that your thing was music, your voice. How would you tell to everyone to find their talent, their dream?
Well, I think we all have a voice. We all have a tremendous power within us. Often it's our family situation or our peers that put us in a box very early, tell us what our ceiling is, what we can achieve, what we can't. It's really a state of mind. A lot of the great singers that I have enjoyed, they don't have what you would say a great classical voice, you know. So, but the way their voice combines with the music is perfect. It's like Snow Rose, is Ian Brown. He's got a very particular voice. When the music surrounds it, it's perfect. If he sounded like Sinatra, the songs wouldn't be right.
Yeah.
But I first found my singing voice in school. My job was to sing the lines of the Lord's Prayer, and everybody joined in with Hallowed Be Thy Name. So I would sing Our Father Who Art in Heaven. The whole school would join in. And it was a tremendous feeling, that, you know, to do that. So just two boys were chosen to be the main singers at the age of 7 or 8. Yeah, when I was very young, they decided that I could sing. I don't know how they decided that, but that was my first performance, would be in school assembly, singing. We always used to sing the Lord's Prayer in the morning.
But you feel in the right moment, right? It was like, yeah, I'm doing something I like. Because sometimes you are good on something, but maybe you don't like it.
Well, yeah, I mean, that's a difficult thing. Sometimes you find something you're good at, but your mind wants you to take you in different places and explore different routes and avenues where, you know, I enjoy, I love singing, I love performing. It's the greatest job, or whatever you want to call it, in the world. You know, it's better, even beats. I wanted to be a footballer when I was a child. But now, I would be retired probably. The career would be over, so like Johnny Cash proved that he wrote some of the greatest material in the last part of his life. And someone like that's a great inspiration. Neil Young, people like that. Bob Dylan, still out there, still playing, still performing. And the great thing now is we've got a young generation, you know. I've just been to Argentina, Chile, and I'm meeting 20-year-old kids who are into it for the first time. Just outside the hotel in Mexico, then there were two lads, 15 and 16 years old, wanting an autograph and a photograph. And it's really exciting for the future. It just means that there's whole generations of kids around the world that they know what's good and they know what isn't, you know what I mean?
Yeah, that's what I wanted to ask you. Like, it's such an honor to have you here. What do you think about music nowadays? How has it changed, like, from your generation to this one?
Well, I think technology has changed it massively. It's now more difficult for potentially a band that has lots of dynamic in the music. So if you start with an acoustic guitar, you're now competing with electronic music, you compete with hip-hop. That acoustic needs to be really loud in the mix. So in the old days, there's lots of dynamic in music. Now, a lot of it hits you at the same volume right from the start. So, dynamics of music have changed, but the song always remains the most important. At the end of time, people will still be sat at a tree with a guitar, expressing what it's like to be a human being.
Music is music, right?
Yeah, it's the most powerful art form in the world. You know, I'm involved, we all are here involved in the most powerful art form in the world. You know, painting, beautiful, fantastic, but often one person buys the picture and puts it in his house, or it goes in a museum.
Music is a moment.
Everyone. And it can capture a feeling that when anyone re-listens to that song, they can instantly go back to that moment. And that's the beauty of music. Music can heal. Music's been proven. And back in the ancient times, they would use tones and different types of music to change cell structure. You know, the ancients probably knew a lot about music and tone, more than what we know now. we only know a fraction of the power of what we're dealing with here. So to then put it in a popular form is really exciting. So it's when I was doing Bittersweet Symphony with Verve, those songs that were worldwide, they were worldwide pop songs, but the feeling and the lyric was very heavy. You know, the first line tells you the score, you're a slave to money and you die. You know what I mean? Deal with it.
I've been longing for this interview because I wanted to, I don't know, me growing up as a child, I listened to Bittersweet Symphony, and then, I don't know, I tried to download it in many places, and I remember me as a child not knowing if it was from Oasis or if it was from,
right, yeah.
Right? And then I just got to the Verve and I just started listening to you, and I don't know, it just changed my point of listening to music. But how's your relationship with Oasis, with the Gallagher brothers? I know you're friends.
Yeah.
Do you still hang out? Do you still do things together?
We still do from time to time, but we've been very busy, you know, and people go in different directions. But I've got a great love for them because at the time when they were on the rise, Noel was very kind and often talking about me and the Verve. He even dedicated one of the songs of Morning Glory to me, Castle Shadow. So that kind of thing really helped the Verve, really helped us, and I really appreciate that. And I want whatever's best for them, whether that means they're on their own or together or whatever. I just want what's the best for them. I respect them, love the guys, and I just wish they have a wish of both for a great future.
Well, I really appreciate that 2016 I finally met you, because I think 2016 took a lot of legends, music legends, you know what I'm talking about. And the thing with this is that Jimmy and I realized that nowadays people who follow us now in MTV are too young that they don't even knew who David Lee was, for example.
Yeah.
And do you think that now you can tell you are a legend?
I don't know really what it's like. I'm going into a different zone now where I've been around long enough for people to appreciate the things I did in the past. So my music from the past is not, it wasn't based on fashion or the moment. It was a timeless thing. It's a human thing. So I'm lucky in that way that when I sing Lucky Man tonight, it means as much to me now as it did when I was 27. And the audience feel it. So I'm involved in songs that will live forever. Whether that makes me a legend or whatever, I don't know. The songs are legendary. My songs will become legendary. Whether I personally am or not, that's a different thing. You know, my performances will be legendary. But a legend when he's going buying milk and some poo bags for his dog, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
We've all got to come down and be human. And that's the thing with the great people, I think. They were very human as well. Because they were very human, their music really translated to normal people. For me, Bittersweet Symphony and songs like that, they are for the dispossessed. They're the song, that is a song for the people struggling. They're struggling, you know. And there's so many people around the world who are struggling. There's only a very finite amount of people that are doing well in this planet. So
I wanted as well, right? Like, we have
ups and downs. We're all in a sort of prison in a way. And it's just how much you break out of that mentally. I broke out of it a little bit partially. I know I'm still under the certain rules, regulations, and laws, etc., etc., but we do our best to bend them, shape them, and shape the older generation, show that we're about to give, and hopefully in the future, you know, we'll see a slightly better world. But at the moment, we're living in a very, 2016 has been a very, a crazy year.
Yeah.
And that's why the artwork for my album, these people, I have the gas mask in the suit. Because I already looked ahead, I already knew where we're headed. I've seen the future and it don't look great. So what it means is, for me as an artist, starting last year here in Mexico, I realized that I have to now be actively out in the world. If only my little bit, only shifts it a tiny bit. We all add up those tiny little shifts in consciousness and our art, and what we do, things will change. But they won't change any other way than that. So, it's been a scary year, but exciting that everything I thought was about to happen is happening. That's why the gas mask there. That's why I'm thinking, you know, we're on the verge. And for us in Europe, for the last few months, we've literally been on the verge of conflict with Russia. And, most of entertainment's there for us to forget that. But I like to be a part of an entertainment that shows a mirror to the world, and it's real. a real sense of what's going on. You know, let's not just pretend we live in a Prozac nation, a Prozac world where everything's like great.
Yeah, everything's perfect.
You know, and I think that was the game.
We need to be conscious about it, right? That the world is.
But we also don't need to be hashtag this all the time, hashtag that. Do something. It's very easy to do hashtag something.
Yeah.
And you think that's it, your job's done now. You sent out a little message into social media and now you've done
but
your
we
bit.
Really have to do it.
You have to do your individual bit. And that might be just in your own home, with your relationships with your own family. You know what I mean? If you can't build it from your own home, then who are you to go out preaching to the world, you know?
That's true. Let's put the heat a little bit down. Maybe we can play a game.
Sure,
like,
why not?
We've got darts, we've got the wheel.
Darts will do me.
I'm sorry, we don't have the time.
Oh, we don't have the time. No worries, it's all right.
But I really think it was a pretty good chat.
Yeah,
I really
loved
it.
It was a pleasure.
Yeah, it was our pleasure.
And I
want
to send a message to all my fans
Please.
Out there. Thank you so much for your support over the years. And I'm back now here. I've recently been to Argentina, Chile, back in Mexico. Next year I'm going to be doing a full South American tour of real venues. And I'm looking forward to it. Love and peace to y'all.
Stay tuned. Esto es MTV News. Seguimos en Corona Capital. Una leyenda, Richard.
Yeah. It's a pleasure, man. Nice one. Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay, and cut.
You guys are so good.